Hello and welcome to Quinterner Bytes. I'm Mofi, a developer advocate in the GKE team, and I have here...
Hi, I'm Tahir Ahmed. I'm the tech lead for GKE Identity.
In this video, Tahir will show us how to easily and securely access GCP resources from GKE. So Tahir, I have a GKE cluster and some GCP resources that I want to access. So to get my GKE cluster to be able to access the GCP resources, do I go about downloading the service account key and then loading that up in my container? Is that how this works?
That's a natural way to think about how you would approach the problem. And it does work, but there are some problems with it. Service account keys are long-lived. They never expire. And they're just hanging around as files or secrets inside your Kubernetes clusters. So anyone who connects to your cluster may be able to get that service account key and then invisibly act as that service account with no indication in audit logs. So these security challenges with exported service account keys were the central motivation for creating Workload Identity Federation for GKE. We were trying to find a simpler way for workloads on GKE to access GCP resources.
My application is running on an autopilot cluster. So to use this Workload Identity Federation, what do I need to do in my cluster?
You actually don't have to do anything because for GKE autopilot clusters, Workload Identity is always enabled and actually can't be turned off.
And what if I have a standard cluster?
On the standard clusters, you do have to enable Workload Identity, which you can do at the time you create the cluster, or you can update an existing cluster to enable Workload Identity. Workload Identity Federation has been around for several years, but it wasn't always so easy to use. Let's take a look at what you used to have to do in order to use Workload Identity Federation to securely access GCP resources. We still document this old approach in the Workload Identity Federation for GKE documentation because there are a few circumstances where it is still required. So the way it used to work is that you have a Kubernetes service account and you will create a GCP service account that is going to be associated one-to-one with that Kubernetes service account. Then you configure IAM permissions so that the Kubernetes service account has permission to impersonate the Google service account with these IAM policy bindings. And then you give the Google service account the permissions it needs in your project. And then there's one final step where you have to tell some machinery within the cluster which GCP service account you want a given Kubernetes service account to try to impersonate. And so overall, it's like a several step process. And if you have many Kubernetes service accounts, you have to manage a fleet of Google service accounts alongside them, which can be a challenge. This is still much better and much more secure than using exported service account keys. A big part of the reason that this approach is more secure than exported service account keys is that the workload is requesting a short-lived, automatically rotated access token from the metadata server. On GKE, when you enable Workload Identity, we have an alternative implementation of the GCE metadata server. We call it GKE metadata server, very creatively. And that metadata server is aware of which pod is calling it to request an access token, so it knows how to return the correct access token for that pod. Over the course of a few years, we've worked closely with GCP IAM to build support across GCP for directly granting permissions to Kubernetes service accounts. We launched this new approach a few months ago, and it significantly cuts down on the number of steps you have to do to securely access GCP resources from GKE. So if we take a look at the user guide for the new approach, we can see that there's basically two steps. You have to create a service account in your cluster, although there is an automatically created one called default that is the default. And then you can use IAM to directly grant permissions to your Kubernetes service account. There's no creation of Google service account, no configuration of impersonation. You just use this new syntax as the member in the IAM policy. It's a bit long, but if we go all the way to the right edge of it, we can see that we're putting in your project ID and then the Kubernetes namespace and Kubernetes service account name that you want to grant permissions to. So this new IAM policy syntax works across most GCP services, including GCS, Firestore, and Vertex AI. If you're using the default service account within your Kubernetes namespace, you don't actually need to create a service account because the default service account already exists, and you would just put default here. So let's take a look at a running application in a real cluster. So in this cluster, there are several running applications, but we're going to take a look at one specific one that is configured to use workload identity for uploading cloud monitoring profiles and traces. So looking at the pod spec, we can see that there's not really any specific configuration that I've had to apply to it. It's running on autopilot, so there's some autopilot inserts a few things, but if we look through, there's nowhere where I have labeled it to be corresponding to a Google service account or anything like that. The only thing I have done in my pod spec is I need to be running it as a particular Kubernetes service account. In this case, that's called WebElator. So now we're looking at the project level IAM policy bindings in my project, and we can see that I have granted some permissions directly to my Kubernetes service account. If we look at this particular policy binding, we can see that I'm referring to my Kubernetes workload. We have my project number, my project name, and then subject/ns/row-major-web/sa/WebElator. Which corresponds exactly to the Kubernetes namespace and Kubernetes service account that my workload was running as. And then over here, we can see that I've assigned it the Cloud Profiler Agent, Cloud Trace Agent, and Monitoring Metric Writer roles. My application is using that to periodically upload Cloud Profiler profiles and Cloud Trace traces, as well as some custom metrics into Cloud Monitoring.
Well, I sure learned a ton, and I will be sure to check out the docs that we link to this video description to change my workload to be able to use Workload Identity Federation. Tahir, is there anything else you want people watching this to remember from this video?
With Workload Identity Federation for GKE, we've made the experience of connecting GKE workloads to GCP resources pretty seamless and secure. GKE is not the only scenario in which you can use Workload Identity Federation machinery to make your connections to GCP easier and more secure at the same time. Workload Identity Federation is a cross-cutting feature of GCP IAM, and there are guides showing you how to configure it for many different scenarios. One that I use myself is the ability to configure GitHub Actions as an identity provider inside Workload Identity Federation. This makes the connections from my continuous integration jobs running in GitHub Actions much more secure because I no longer have to export a service account key and store it inside a GitHub Actions secret.
Thank you so much, Tahir. And we're going to come back in the future with more interesting GKE and security topics. So stay tuned.
Thanks. It was a pleasure to be here.